We weren't out dancing or anything like that. We were getting ready for a war.
The thing was, you were in the army, you had to do as you're told, you had one master or dozens, but you just had to get on with it, and that was it.
I did find that right through the army. If you behaved yourself, you had nothing much to fear.
This was quite a new world to us. I mean, you can imagine, I came out of civilian life like all the others did, and we weren't in a position to argue or object. It was just a matter of doing what we were told.
I liked it. I liked to be told what I had to do, because there was a reason for doing it. And later on, I realised that was the best training you could have.
The first week, our route march would be 10 miles. The second week, it would be 12, and so on and so on. It intensified because it's of the utmost importance that the infantry soldier could march with a full kit.
What you had to carry was 109 pounds.
The marching was easy for me, but quite a lot of chaps who were in sedentary jobs found it pretty hard.
It numbed and cramped the muscles on my thighs and calves until they hurt very much indeed.
Oh, those army boots. I could have cried. My feet and ankles with those heavy army boots after civilian shoes.
So to get your boots made pliable, you used to urinate in them and leave it overnight.
Quite a lot of men were clerks or they'd worked in shops, and the very nature of their calling didn't make for fitness.
Well, they sent me to hospital and they gave me the cure for hookworm, and I found that I could stand a drill after that.
They used to march us all round the West End. Crowds used to foregather, and some of the poor deluded ones fell for the con trick and lined up behind us, and we used to march them all down to Chelsea Barracks where they got signed up.
Lunch would consist of inevitable stew. Now, we must remember that the chaps in the cookhouse were by no means experienced cooks, but anybody can make a stew, and that's what they did.
Sometimes you got a bit of plum duff and milk puddings and tapioca rice. It was a good old-fashioned plain stuff that I was brought up on. I had no complaint about it.
In the afternoon, it could be a lecture on Vickers machine guns.
They used to strip the machine gun right down and put it together again. And luckily, I seemed to get cotton under that quite quickly.
We're always told the man's best friend is his rifle. And it was.
Our rifle was a Shortley Enfield, a very good rifle indeed, a real sturdy rifle. You had your ammunition pouches on both sides of the chest to counterbalance the weight of the pack. And those pouches carried 150 rounds of .303 ammunition.
We were supposed to hold a rifle up with one hand, but I could never hold a rifle properly. My right wrist wouldn't hold it up.
I'd never fired a rifle in my life. But on the first day, we went onto the rifle range, and it was amazing the bullseyes I was getting. So the next thing, I was made a first-class rifleman.
Above all, we learned rapid fire. 10 rounds, and get those 10 rounds onto the target in 1 minute. It was known as the Mad Minute.
I'd never seen a dead man or anything of that kind, and I wondered if it came to my shooting a man whether I would be able to do this.
And plunge the bayonet into the sack and shout like hell.
And it would tell you where to put your bayonet, either into his left shoulder, his right shoulder, in the chest or in the body.
We were told to make as much noise as we could. I think that was sort of to frighten the enemy. Didn't seem to me to be a likely thing to do, but we used to shout.
When you train as a division, there's 12 battalions, there's roughly 12,000 men, are on the move, and you're a very small cog in a big wheel.
Saturday mornings, we were let off, but we had to do sometimes barrack duties, and then on Sundays, we were all marched down to church. Didn't matter what religion you were, you all had to go, and that was it.